The war in Ukraine has sharpened the focus on Russia's plans for the world. Plans which had been in motion for a while. Remember the armed interventions in Georgia, Syria, Libya? And the spread of the Kremlin's military influence goes much further, sometimes to unexpected places. These are reports in Russian newspapers from 2021 that we have voiced up. They're claiming that the Russian language was being made compulsory for university students in the Central African Republic. When I saw the story, and it did make the rounds globally, it reminded me of my school days in Bulgaria when I had to learn Russian, whether I liked it or not, because Bulgaria was part of the Soviet bloc. But the Central African Republic wasn't in the sphere of Soviet influence, and so the ongoing Russian involvement here is curious. What's Moscow's aim? And with the world reeling from the invasion of Ukraine, how do Russia's moves in Africa fit into this rearranged global jigsaw? I'm Krassi, and this is The Global Jigsaw, an original podcast from BBC Monitoring, zooming in on political, security and social shifts around the world through the lens of its media. Our team listens to, watches and analyzes media narratives in 100 languages.
Radio Tehran.
Right, we must go now to Moscow.
Western countries are not the international community. That era has finished.
I mean, have you got any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, you know,
Putin
is the worst.
Among the journalists covering Africa for BBC Monitoring is my colleague Beverly Ochieng.
I assumed it would be in the morning bulletin.
Bev is a Kenyan media analyst at work in Nairobi.
You would think they would have it here, but they don't. It's just...
And here she's looking for something specific, for news of protests in Bongi, the capital of the Central African Republic, or CAR as it's known. But she drew a blank. And that's something which happens a lot when she watches this particular country.
The main source, if you're outside the CAR, you have this one radio station, an EU-funded radio called Ndeke Luka. It tends to do a lot of authoritative reporting, but also some debunking, and they also train journalists. Episodes of urgent information coming out from websites like Kobo News Centrafrique or Journal de Bangui or Abangui. Information from the CAR can feel quite patchy. And this is because years of rebel violence and civil war has really undermined operations. And in many instances, journalists tend to be the ones in the crosshairs of this violence. At the same time, you have very low levels of internet accessibility. You have a ripe ground for influence campaigns, misinformation, inaccurate reports. And then at the heart of all of this, there's this pro-Kremlin radio.
Pro-Kremlin radio? How did that come about?
So Radio Lengosongo was launched by Russian businessmen. The radio itself, Lengosongo, means reconciliation or solidarity. It was supposed to be a sort of peace radio. In many instances, it would be hosting pro-Russian politicians or even people from the ruling party, but it also broadcasts Russian language lessons.
That brings us back to our starting point, a story that featured widely in Western media.
I mean, it was a bizarre story, you know, about how Russian became compulsory, and it was picked up by predominantly Kobo News. And they were citing a cabinet meeting, which President Faustin Touadera had sort of made this announcement. When this came out, there was no actual corroborating government statement, but it made quite a bit of momentum.
Many people won't know the history of the CAR, and as we've seen, there's little coverage of it. So to understand what drew the Russians in, our BBC Africa colleague, Aisha Afra, put together this fact file to take us through some of the events of the last 10 years.
The Central African Republic is one of the world's poorest countries.
yet has natural mineral deposits like copper, gold, and uranium, which the tech world now wants. A civil war started in 2013, when a coalition of mostly Muslim armed groups called the Seleka marched on the capital. Then, a group of mostly Christian militias set up what they called anti-balaka, meaning anti-machete, and the country descended yet again into war. In 2014, a UN peacekeeping force called MINUSCA was formed to stop the fighting, and current President Todera signed a peace deal with the armed groups. But there was no peace. Early in 2021, a coalition of UN peacekeepers, Rwandan troops, and Russian contractors repelled a rebel attack on the capital. The Russian contractors, the Wagner Group, have been active in the country since 2017. At the same time, the influence of France, the former colonial master, has diminished, while Russian influence grows.
This brings us back to our Russian language story. It was impossible to verify by looking at media reports from outside the CAR. So I caught up with one of the few foreign correspondents based in Bongi at the time, Clément Di Roma.
People, you know, mostly listen to radio, so and mostly it's not very reliable, like it's just state propaganda or just like very basic information about what's going on. And some news outlets are like government-backed, other news outlets are pro-Russian, and others are like on the French side. You're in a country where there's basically no electricity or very little electricity, you know, very little infrastructures.
One particular story, which is a good example of these kind of difficulties trying to understand is something true or not, about Russian becoming compulsory in universities. Is that true?
So Russian becoming compulsory is definitely, you know, one of those fake news that we can trace back actually to Russian news outlets. Anyone who knows, I think the university here in Bangui knows that this type of process isn't really possible. There's even a Russian cultural center. They're going to teach Russian classes, but there's only one teacher.
So as far as we can tell, these compulsory Russian lessons don't exist. We contacted the Bongi University, but received no answer. It's not easy to establish simple facts in the CAR. The protagonists of this story, the Wagner Group, have attracted a lot of media attention lately over their involvement in the war in Ukraine. But they've been in business for a while. Their presence in Bongi was first reported in 2017.
So at the very start, when Russia had deployed military instructors, mostly the government and even media would stick to calling them military contractors. Hobo News always refers to them as Wagner mercenaries. So in 2020, the mercenaries themselves became quite prevalent. They were talked about in the media as Russian mercenaries who are providing security to the president. At this point, they made extensive changes to the mining code. And the CAR is rich in minerals, diamonds, rubies, gold, you name it. So when this mining code came into place, there was almost immediately an increase in violence in areas which are both rebel-held territories as well as areas with mineral deposits.
It would seem that exploring commercial opportunities is one reason for Russian companies' interest in this mineral-rich country. But it has led to further violence in an already unstable and complex security environment. And in this sparse media landscape, it's hard to know how many people have died, let alone how many of the deaths are directly linked to Wagner.
Civilians were being disproportionately targeted for alleged links with rebels or for flouting that mining code, which was sort of protecting Wagner and being able to give it its concessions. A lot of this was being documented, I recall, by Kobo News and also French media, RFI, Jeune Afrique, because of just how remote these areas are. A community that was disproportionately targeted was the Fulani because of the fact that many rebels tend to come from that community. So all sorts of atrocities being reported. And then you had reports from UN agencies, of course, calling out the atrocities. And the government often pushed back on this. But then there are some accounts which actively keep tabs of what are the levels of violence taking place. It was found, for instance, that when Wagner mercenaries are operating on their own, there's a lot more in terms of civilian casualties compared with if they're together with the army.
Away from the alleged atrocities by Wagner mercenaries outside Bongi, there's been a different kind of push in the capital, a charm offensive. Clement mentioned earlier that there was a Russian cultural center. And I came across a report from 2018 about a beauty contest that was financed by a company specializing in gold and diamond mining, with links to the Russian city of St. Petersburg. A former Miss Russia graced the event. This has been reported outside of the CAR as Moscow's soft power push. How has it gone down locally?
Some of the commentary was that this was a celebration of relations between Russia and the CAR. And we've seen a similar thing with Russia sponsoring football tournaments or a competition for children. And it's a very deliberate way of reaching out to other parts of society.
I spotted a story about this poetry competition for local children, and the award for it apparently was a trip to Crimea, which of course Russia seized from Ukraine in 2014. So has this charm offensive won over the local population?
I say it depends on what media outlet you're looking at. Some of the commentary that is picked up by outlets like Kobo News, you will think that there is this growing support towards Russian presence. If you are reading about the accounts of atrocities, you will see the other side of it, where people feel that there is a very sinister relationship between Russia and the CAR, and that there needs to be accountability.
Allegations of atrocities presented a challenge for Moscow. So they reached for the megaphone. And Enter the Tourist, a feature-length movie which premiered in the main stadium in Bongi in 2021.
It was very much a Rambo-style film. I remember watching it. There was a white man, blue-eyed, you know, a bit of dust in the background, a bit of chaos, and being portrayed as this hero coming into the CAR. It was full of gore, action, but it was interesting how the publicity sort of played out. I had seen some comments on social media that expressed pride that this film had been shot in the CAR. Мирных жителей не обижают. Половые отношения с местной
флорой и фауной не вступают. Vitaly Shevchenko, the Russia editor at BBC Monitoring, has been following the country's media for 20 years. He's Ukrainian and one of the presenters of the award-winning Ukraine cast. He'll help us understand Moscow's narrative. Vitaly, did you see The Tourist?
Unfortunately, I did. I didn't like it. It's a pretty two-dimensional film, if you ask me, with a very clear objective.
I noticed in the English version, it says it's dedicated to Russian gladiators. And in the Russian version, it's called dedicated to soldier liberators. There's symbolism in the language, isn't there? Because that isn't even a subtle difference.
Absolutely. I think in advertising speak, this is called localization, i.e. catering to the tastes and interests of the local audience. So for audiences in Russia, liberator soldiers would carry clear similarities with how warriors against Nazism in the Second World War were portrayed. So the implication is that the warriors in Africa, they continue the glorious tradition of our forefathers defeating the absolute evil like Nazism.
Forefathers are often venerated with statues of their heroic deeds. Soviet army monuments are scattered across the Eastern Bloc. And now there's a new statue of Russia's military men near Bongi's only university. I asked Clément Di Roma, the journalist you heard earlier, to describe it.
It represents four soldiers, two Russian and two Central African, pointing their guns at invisible rebel enemies while protecting a woman with her two children. The monument was inaugurated by Central African officials and Russian officials. Even the president for Saint-Archange Trois-des-Arts was here. The point of the statue is to show how powerful the Russian presence and propaganda is here in the Central African Republic, even though the Russian military forces here are accused of violations of human rights by the UN.
A question for Vitaly. What message is this action thriller sending to audiences at home in Russia?
In 2018, three Russian journalists trying to investigate Wagner's involvement in the Central African Republic got killed. And obviously that led to very unflattering reports about Wagner. So 3 years later, we see this film about how Russian instructors are taking part in actual combat. So the film is about how good they are, how justified their involvement is, and it's pretty much a black and white depiction of good and evil, even though the film's in colour.
How is the death of these three journalists investigating the activities of Wagner, how is it reflected in Russian media?
Very obviously, it's attracted a lot of interest, but also, understandably, the message was very clear. You try and investigate Wagner, you might pay the ultimate price.
The film is trying to put the record straight from Moscow's perspective. The military instructors are deployed to help, advise and rescue. The baddies in the movie are the French and the rebels. What else does the Russian media consumer know about Wagner's activities in the CAR?
It wasn't a subject that the media could explore freely. And the reason for that was specifically the reason, precisely the reason why Wagner was set up. There had to be a distance between what the government was doing and what these people were doing, even if their objectives were very similar to the government's objectives. What I'm talking about are things like fighting in Ukraine, then Syria, then Libya. And you will remember that back then, the Kremlin insisted that it had nothing to do with Russia, really. The point is plausible deniability, because the state apparatus in Russia is run by a former KGB officer. That's how the system works. Secrecy, deniability, take precedence over things like military valor, pride in what military is doing. And at the same time, give the Kremlin enough wriggle room to say, look, we don't really know who these people are. We didn't send them there.
As Vitaly said, pro-Kremlin media had for years avoided mentioning Wagner or denied its existence. Then, at the end of July 2022, that changed.
Объект освобождали специалисты частной военной компании Wagner, те самые музыканты, тот самый оркестр.
This is the main evening bulletin on state-run Russia One, name-checking Wagner for the first time. 2 months later, Yevgeny Prigozhin, the man known as Putin's chef, who'd been suspected of being behind Wagner from the start, admitted he founded the company in 2014.
The Kremlin decided that this facade of plausible deniability wasn't really working to run this operation in Ukraine secretly, because that imposed its own constraints on the scale of Russian involvement. That's when the masks were off. That's when we saw what a lot of people suspected, really, that it was the Russian state all along.
With much of Russia's attention and resources focused in Ukraine, there was bound to be an impact on operations elsewhere. So did the behavior of Wagner mercenaries change in the CAR?
Yes, it has changed fairly significantly. We started off with between 1,000 and 2,000 mercenaries at the height of when they were being deployed to the CAR. And now there are reports that it's only half that number. And interestingly, more of the reports emerging talk about mercenaries of Syrian or Libyan origin rather than the Russians themselves. Because bearing in mind the fact that the Kremlin has been sanctioned as a result of the war and so is not quite able to fund mercenaries.
So how are they helping themselves?
the mercenaries have diversified their economic interests. Some of it is quite dubious. A lot of it is very extractive. There's also been reports of excessive looting of property and businesses, particularly Chinese-owned businesses. But there are also business ventures that have seen links between the CAR, Cameroon, which is neighboring, and Russia. So in 2022, Wagner began investing in the forestry sector and coffee and sugar. And there's also vodka production, which in the CAR, it wasn't there before. But now they're producing vodka in sachets and selling it in the public.
With talk of looting, logging and liquor, the remaining Wagner mercenaries in the CAR may have found ways to ride out the uncertain times. But as the war in Ukraine rapidly depletes Russian resources, what's the future of Moscow's strategy in Africa?
What's happened in Ukraine has had massive repercussions for what Russia can and cannot do in places like Africa. This war has been going on for months and months, and Russia is still deeply mired. It needs more men to go and fight in Ukraine. And because of that shortage of fighters, a lot of them, as far as we know, have had to be redeployed to Ukraine. Of course, it remains to be seen what it actually means for Russia's plans in the Central African Republic. But what is undeniable is that Russia's priorities will have to change. Russia will have to rethink what it can do in Africa.
Russia's influence in Africa goes back a long way. Moscow never established a colony on the continent, but it did play an active role in the so-called Second Scramble for Africa, when, during the Cold War, the Soviet Union and the US competed to win the allegiance of newly independent African states. Generations of African leaders were educated in the USSR, and many still speak the language. And this legacy has proved extremely useful as the Russians look for new friends.
In 2020, of course, when they were able to push back the rebels, it was largely touted as something bigger than what any other intervening power like France or Libya or South Africa was able to do for the CAR, and this gave them a sort of positive reputation. But underlying this were all of the other things that Russia has also been doing. So you think about the Soviet Union during the period of the Cold War, there were post-independence movements, and many people were either being educated in Moscow or receiving military support. And this has sort of resonated for some time. There's also how Russia presents itself. It plays on a lot of things which obviously touch off on anti-Western sentiment. So in the run-up to the war itself, and even before that, they talk about how, you know, we've never colonized you, which was sort of, they're supposed to be the antithesis of the West. And for countries that are trying to overcome some of the negative impacts of colonialism, Russia has presented itself as an answer, even though it hasn't yet quite proven itself.
President Vladimir Putin once told the Russian nation that the collapse of the Soviet Union was the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the 20th century. It's often been said that this gave an insight into his big plan. Here's a final thought from Vitaly.
Well, there are two levels on which Russia functions abroad. One is geopolitical. Of course, the Kremlin and President Putin personally, they took enormous pride and pleasure in having kicked out France out of its former colonies, such as Mali. President Putin's geopolitical ambitions are absolutely toweringly huge. I'm talking about his expansionist politics. But the second reason is more practical. Of course, those parts of Africa are rich in natural resources, which are worth a lot of money. And by claiming control of them, of course, it motivates the fighters that have been fighting for all those geopolitical purposes. Of course, it helps fund them. And of course, it helps enrich the inner circle within Russia and help this machine going.
As Russia becomes more isolated from the West, it's looking for opportunities to expand its influence where it can. sometimes stepping into shrinking Western footprints, often leaning on its Soviet-era prestige. And it might just be working in some parts of Africa. A UN General Assembly vote deploring the invasion of Ukraine just weeks after troops marched across the border produced a striking result. 17 African countries, including the CAR, refused to condemn the invasion. One, Eritrea, supported it. A year later, Mali voted for it too. While Moscow was hit with tough sanctions over the war by the West, it had quiet support from its friends in Africa. Thanks to Vitaly Shevchenko, Beverly Ochieng, Clement Di Roma, and Aisha Afra. The producers are Anne Dixey and Krista Satori. The sound engineer is Martin Appleby, and our editor is Judy King. And if you missed it, do listen to our last episode, which asks why the Chinese Communist Party has been talking about masculinity. And if you can, subscribe or follow The Global Jigsaw so you never miss an edition. But for now, I'm Krassi Twigg. Do join us again next time and get in touch with your feedback. Our email address is theglobaljigsaw, all one word, @bbc.co.uk.